No one can disagree that SpaceX is the best aerospace company in the world, launching 100 times per year, managing the biggest satellite constellation in history, and being the only one reusing their rockets. But they are not perfect. This summer they had a couple of failures, and they will have more in the future, so it seems like a good idea to have other options. But who can compete with them? Boeing? Not after the huge fiasco they did with Starliner. Rocket Lab? They are too small, and Neutron is still a long shot. ULA? Don't be ridiculous, they cannot even sell the company for a few bucks. Then, who else can challenge the SpaceX dominance? For many years, there has been a sleeping giant waiting in the shadows, a huge company with lots of money that was always promising a slow but big surprise. And finally, after more than 20 years, they are ready to show what they are hiding under the hood. Last month, Jeff Bezos showed for the first time what they have been working on at Blue Origin, proving that all the promises that he made were based on reality and not only fiction. And after allowing us to have a look at the latest advancements, we can finally make a fair judgment about their aspirations. But looks can be deceiving, and huge factories don't always guarantee a good product, so let's have a closer look at the true state of Blue Origin, and finally have a good idea about the real options to compete with SpaceX. Everything started when Jeff was a little kid, and he was dreaming about space and the role that humanity could have on it. He pictured huge O'Neill cylinders accommodating millions of people. He imagined moving all the heavy industry to space so that we could keep our planet clean and pure. He visualized a future where people would live in space colonies and Earth would be a natural reserve, full of life, and without the inconvenience of the human species moving around, polluting the environment. He was truly a visionary, but all these dreams were just dreams, nothing else. They were futuristic scenarios that were too far from his reach, and as he could not yet fulfill his fantasies, he decided to sell books online with the stories that others wrote. Jokes apart, building a space economy is hard and expensive, much more than we could ever imagine, so even though Jeff had big ambitions, he needed lots of money to have a chance to chase his dreams. So before starting a space company and trying to reach his childhood fantasies, he started Amazon and the rest is history, but we are not here to dive into it. We are here to understand how in the middle of all this internet madness, a group of space nerds started to fulfill their biggest dreams. So when the internet bubble was at the top, and with all the billions he had from the Amazon valuation, Jeff started Blue Origin. At the beginning, it was nothing more than a think tank and a small secretive lab that were trying to develop the technology to make life in space a reality. So from its inception in the year 2000 until 10 years later, they did nothing more than small experiments with little rockets, something closer to a rocket club with lots of money than to a company funded by a billionaire with the goal to change life on Earth. During these 10 years, they developed their little toys without any sense of urgency, but that was okay. They were not supposed to do anything else. This was just the start of something much bigger, and Jeff was in no hurry. But while Jeff was developing his project step by step, methodically, and focusing on safety and reliability, another space nerd with some money and big ambitions was trying to solve the same problem, but with a hardcore, fast, and not so methodical way. In the same time as Blue Origin did basically some small tests with suborbital rockets without any given purpose, SpaceX, led by Elon Musk, developed and successfully launched a small orbital rocket, a big orbital rocket, and even a capsule capable of sending cargo to the International Space Station. Even if your objective is to go slow and do things at your pace, seeing how another company rapidly outpaces you and fulfills decades of development in just a few years is enough to make you change your mind. So Jeff was no longer so gratitude and began to be more ferociter. He tried, and from 2010 to 2020, Blue Origin developed and started to launch the New Shepard, a small suborbital rocket that was supposed to send people to the border of space and be the base of future developments. But it wasn't enough, and they couldn't even put people in it until 2021, so again they were too slow. During this decade, SpaceX had vastly outpaced them again, as they had started the Starlink constellation and even developed the Falcon Heavy, the biggest rocket at that time. And let's not forget that they also won the contract to send astronauts to the ISS, and they developed the capsule 4 years earlier than its competitor and for half the cost. So again, Jeff found himself in a weird situation. Having invested nearly $10 billion into Blue Origin and having nothing to show for it, he needed a change, a big change. It was not possible that after 20 years and many billions, he hadn't sent anything into orbit. Nothing, not even a small satellite with a small rocket, while its main competitor had gone from zero to the biggest aerospace company of all time. So he doubled down on its ambitions and decided to push harder on the new Glenn, the giant rocket that was not only supposed to compete with the Falcon 9, but even with the new and fully reusable Starship. Many people thought Jeff was crazy. How are you going for a 100 meters monster capable of sending 45 tons to space for your first orbital rocket? And you want to recover the first stage too? That took SpaceX almost a decade to accomplish, so almost everyone thought he was not serious. But then, he showed us what he was hiding under his factory. Blue Origin had been operating in the dark for most of its history, not showing anything until it was already done and being very secretive about their developments, but after changing the CEO and starting to brag a little bit on social media, they also opened the doors of the main factory to one of the best aerospace communicators that we have, Tim Dodd, the everyday astronaut. So for the first time we could see the interior of the Blue Origin buildings, and Jeff showed Tim, and all of us, what they have been doing during all this time. He explained how the orthogrid for the first stage is the most optimal solution, he showed the gigantic actuators for the fins, and explained with some detail how the engines for the second stage are unique and have a very efficient design. But you need much more if you want to compete with the Falcon 9 that is launching every 2 or 3 days. It won't be enough if you are only doing the same as ULA does now. So he had to expose their plant not only to launch a couple of times per month, but to recover the first stage too, and even the aspirations of reusing the second stage and have a true rival to the Starship rocket. Jeff had also to convince us that they are ready to mass produce this rocket and that they want to have a huge fleet of first stages that can be prepared every 14 days so that they can launch at the same pace as the current leader. He was very happy to show the world about his most precious creation, and the hardware and factories that they have are truly amazing, but after watching the tour in detail and listening carefully to what Jeff said, I was really surprised about the lack of innovation, and I was left with a bad feeling about all of this. Don't get me wrong, Jeff Bezos is an amazing entrepreneur, he is truly a space nerd and has done more for the space industry than every single one of us watching this video, but when someone shows what he does and explains his plans, they are open to criticism and analysis, and that's what we are doing here. The goal of Blue Origin is very ambitious and I think it's a good one, but the path to reach this goal seems a little off, especially when you have other companies following other plans that are more realistic and that have proven to be successful. Let's start with the elephant in the room, how much money has Jeff put into it without getting anything in return? When you look at the factory and all the equipment they have, you cannot stop thinking about all the resources needed to build it and maintain it. They have around 10,000 employees, that's 1 billion per year at minimum just to pay the paychecks. In total, it's estimated that Jeff has spent $10 billion on this project. SpaceX developed the Falcon 1, the Falcon 9 and Heavy, and the Cargo Dragon capsule for around $1.5 billion. In total, Blue Origin is just burning money without any results for now. Okay, but that was before. Now they have changed the mindset and they are more efficient and fast. Wrong. If you listen to Jeff and you see the procedures that they use to build rockets, they are as expensive as they get. They are copying the techniques that Boeing uses for the SLS, instead of copying what SpaceX does for the Falcon 9, that has proven to be the most efficient and economic rocket ever. Jeff brags about using the biggest actuators for the fins, as if something big and heavy in a rocket was a good thing. He tries to explain why the orthogrid is the best option for reusable rockets when they know almost nothing about reusing rockets. He attempts to argue that they are trying to lower the cost of the second stage while also trying to make it reusable to see which solution is better when you already have the answer in the Falcon 9 and Starship. He is trying to reinvent the wheel when you have another company that just invented it in front of you, and while the rest of the world is trying to copy SpaceX, Jeff thinks he can provide a better solution. He is not stupid, Jeff is a very capable man, and that might be his weakest point, trying to prove to the world that he can do it in his own way when he has better options in front of him. I admire his tenacity and his ambitions, but he needs to realize that no matter how many good engineers you hire, no matter how much money you put into this, as long as you don't make good decisions, you won't be advancing in any way. If one does not know which port one is sailing, no wind is favorable, and Jeff has lots of wind, but he's ignoring the results of previous sailors, and that is usually a bad idea. But what do you think? Is Jeff wrong about Blue Origin, or I am wrong criticizing him? Leave a comment with your thoughts and subscribe if you want more of this. And as always, take care and learn more.